Good morning, students. Welcome to the virtual classrooms. We are studying the chapter number 5, the gaseous states. Today we are going to have it as a last lecture. This particular lecture, it's a completely theoretical base. Whatever I'm discussing with you, it's an oral discussions. Majority of the points will be there. You will have to read it in your textbook, these points clearly, so that you get it as a clear idea what we studied in this lecture, because it's a majority part. This is theoretical part, right? It's an oral discussion to understand it. Like we are having it as a, the topic as kinetic molecular theory of the gases. The point that we are discussing at present is kinetic molecular theory of, now in this case when we are going to discuss about the kinetic theory, what is it going to help us? We are going to discuss about the characteristic, why the gases are compressible, why they are moving, why they are not reacting with one another, like that, different conditions, different points that we are going to discuss. Like the first point that I want to discuss it, that is the gaseous molecules are compressible. We know that whatever the gaseous molecules we are taking it, they are compressible. I can compress them. We can, if I take a balloon, it's filled with air. If we want it, we can bring them closer to one another. We can burst the balloon also. Now what is the reason behind it? Why these gases are compressible? Then it indicates that they are very small as compared to the volume that we, in which we are filling up, or the volume of the container that we are taking it. So they are considered to be as a point, right? And as they are away from one another, apart from one another, and being in very small in the size, we can bring them closer to one another, and that is the reason why we say that they are compressible. So kinetic molecular theory helps us to understand that first point, that why the gases are compressible. That is your first point, right? These are all the postulates in your textbook with an explanation. They have been given out, you can read them, right? Okay, the second point, that is when we are making them to come closer with one another, so that means there is no intermolecular forces of attraction. We have studied it, solids are having maximum intermolecular forces, liquids are comparatively less, and gases are not having it, or the minimum intermolecular forces are there, right? How can we prove that? So that is what we told it. If we are applying the pressure onto the balloons, the gases molecules are coming closer to one another. If they are having some intermolecular forces, then either they would be able to compress up to certain level, or they would have been non-compressible, right? So that shows that these gases, these particles at a certain ordinary temperature, they don't have any intermolecular forces acting between them, and that is the reason why they are also remaining apart from one another. Force of attraction would be there, then they won't have gone to the apart. And we know that gases occupies the whole volume of the container in which it is being filled, right? So that shows that they don't have intermolecular forces also, and that is the reason why they are moving apart, or when they are compressed, they are coming closer, so there is no intermolecular forces that is acting on them. The third postulate, we can say that these gases molecules are always in a constant motion. We know it, that they occupy the complete space provided to them, so they are having it as a continuous motion, and that also random motion. They don't move it with the same in a one direction or in a straight line or like that. They are having it as a random motion, right? The fourth one, the particles of the gases moves in an possible directions, wherever, random motions, whichever the directions you are providing to them, they can move it in random direction with the wherever the conditions they are allowed it to move, and that is the reason why when they are moving it, they collide with one another. They collide with one another. That means from coming from one direction, coming from the other side, they collide with one another. And during the collision, they transfer their energy, they change their speed. And because of it, we can say that they exert a pressure on each other. Now, during the motion, they not only collide with the each other, even certain molecules, they collide with the wall of the container. The gas is filled in a certain container. That container is having an wall. They collide with that wall also. And during that case also, they exert a pressure onto that wall. Right? That pressure, in general case, we don't consider it as an ideal gas equation. So we will have to consider that pressure. So that is, we are going to have it in our next theory as an van der Waals equations. That is going to change that ideal and real gases. Right? The next one, the total energy of the molecules before and after collision. The total energy inside the container is going to remain same. Because before and after collision also, one have transferred the energy to the other, but the total energy is remain is same. So total energy even before and after the collision, it's going to remain same. And because of this collision, what we can say, the molecular speeds that we just studied it in our last lecture, that they are having it as a change into their different speeds. Some of them we calculate it as average speed, sometimes we calculate it as most probable speed, or we also calculate it as root mean square velocities. So that means these gases, they are having it as in some specific characteristic, right? Okay, and because of this theory, it was a van der Waals. He changed the ideal gas concept. He told that there are no ideal gases. There are no ideal gases. Certain gases, they are all real gases. They are all real gases. Under certain conditions, under specific temperature pressure conditions, the real gases behaves as an ideal gases. It's like us. In normal condition, we say that I am the perfect. But under certain conditions, if you have been told that how much perfect you are in any given field, then you can say that up to certain extent. You can't say that I am 100% in that field, right? If you are told that how much computer do you know, if you say that I am masters in computer, if you have been given out every factor, can we? No, we are restricted to certain levels, right? So that is known as the real. Under certain conditions, if you have been told that under the computer, you have been told that go for Excel, Microsoft Excel, you are master in it. But if you are told that go for Microsoft Outlook, then it becomes somewhat difficult. So that means under the certain conditions, the real gases behaves as if they are ideal gases. Otherwise, there are no ideal gases. And that's the reason why he plotted the graph and he told it that if this is a condition of an ideal gas, then at this specific temperature pressure, the graph was plotted of PV against P. Then it was told that this is an ideal condition. Then if this is at CH4, then this graph will be accordingly. These are all real gas condition. This is the particular temperature pressure volume where it behaves as an ideal gas. Similarly, if you plot it for CO2, you can say that the value of the graph to be changed, it's changed, right? Even the pressure temperature for it, it's changed. At the same time, he told that there are the two gases, H2, HE. They never go for the ideal conditions. These are the two gases, they never go for at any temperature pressure, they never create any kind of an ideal gases in it, right? So we can say that hydrogen and helium are the two gases which never created an ideal condition. Now why this factor was given out or why this was being calculated? So for that case, it was told that ideal gas means PV is equals to nRT. So PV by nRT, if it is an ideal, answer should be 1. But it was found out that answer did not came out to be 1. It was not equals to 1. PV by nRT for all gases were not equals to 1. So they told that PV by nRT is equals to Z is a compressibility factor that will be different. If high temperature is there, pressure will be if high pressure is there, temperature is high, pressure is high, the gases will have higher compressibility factor. If it is low pressure, low pressure, compressibility of that gases molecules will be less. So that is a compressibility factor, but that is given out as PV by nRT should be 1 for ideal gas, but it's never coming out to be as in 1. Now how did van der Waal explain that it did not came out to be 1, or what is the reason for not coming out to be 1? So for that case, let us consider that if I am taking it as a container, right, I am filling up a gas, I am putting it, these are the gases molecules that I am placing it. Now out of the total volume, certain volume is occupied by this gases molecule. Now if I say that these gases molecule is there, it's present over here, can this whole volume is available for all the molecules? No, the space occupied by these gas, it's not available. So that means the total volume, it's not available for each gases component to occupy it. That means we will be having it as an V minus NB to be calculated, that is number of molecules into this B is constant. It's a van der Waals constant. So this is the actual volume that is available for the molecules to move. Right? Second factor, a previous theory, we discussed that these molecules are moving it. When they are moving it, they collide with one another. At that time they exert a pressure on it. At the same time, they collide onto the container also. They exert a pressure over there also. Did we consider that pressure initially for the ideal gas? No. At that time, this pressure, the value was very, very less, so it was neglected. But overall, the pressure is there in it. So that pressure, if I consider it, then the P, I am going to get it as An square by V square. Again, A is van der Waals constant. Right, so this we are going to get it as P plus An square by V square. A is a van der Waals constant, N is a number of molecules that are colliding in the inversely proportional to the volume. So that means now if I am putting it as PV is equals to nRT, that is been replaced by P plus An square by V square. V minus NB is equals to nRT. This is the new van der Waals equation that we are getting it. Right? So because of this, we got it as real gas and ideal gas conditions. So every gases, they behave as an ideal gas under specific condition. Otherwise, in the normal temperature pressure, they behave as real gases, right? Now, if Z is equals to 1, in this case, if Z is equals to 1, it will be an ideal gas. If Z is greater, when? If the pressure is high, Z will be greater than 1, if the pressure is high. Z will be less than 1, if the pressure is low, right? So that is the theory of ideal and real gases, which was given out by van der Waal. Okay, next theory that we are having it, that is liquefaction of the gases. Now what does this indicate? Till now, we studied it, that if the temperature is brought down for any gaseous component, it will get converted into liquid. But only by changing the temperature will it convert itself into the liquid? No. There were the scientists who studied it that only by decreasing the temperature the gases are not going to convert itself into the liquid. We also say that by applying the pressure we can convert it into liquid by bringing the molecules closer to one another. Was it correct? Again, the scientists told that only by changing the pressure can't change the gaseous molecule into liquid. It is both temperature and pressure has to be changed. So at specific temperature and pressure only, the gaseous molecules can be converted into liquids, right? Till today, before I am discussing with you, you know it that you consider CO2 as a sublimation. You have studied that CO2 can be converted into solid and solid as a dry ice. And dry ice is straight away converted into gaseous molecules of CO2. That is, you consider it as a sublimation, right? It never reaches to the liquid state. But it's not so. We can bring the CO2 also in the liquid state. This was very first time studied by the scientist that temperature and pressure both are the responsible factor to change the solid into liquid or gas into liquid factor. So for that case, they took it as an example of CO2, and particularly they plotted a graph of it. They plotted the, for the liquefaction of the gases, they plotted a graph of P against V. Right? What did they told for that graph? That at specific temperature, I'm putting this as an A. Right? This you can, theory is given in your textbook. Right? I'm discussing directly onto the graph. I'm not writing all the theories. In the exam, you have to plot the graph as well as you will have to write the theory also, explaining the graph. Right? This is one of the question, theoretical question. You can say that in the exam, as a theoretical question, you can be asked, explain liquefactions of the gases. Right? What does it show? That at this temperature and pressure, this is as a gas. When its volume is decreased, that means by increasing the pressure, we know that pressure and volume are inversely proportional. So by decreasing the pressure, increasing the pressure, volume decreases. A stage comes after which the liquefaction of the gases start from B to C, liquid plus gas. The condition is it becomes as a liquid plus gas. That means the liquid starts the formation, certain crystals, certain molecules of the gases starts to convert themselves into liquid. But after that, whatever the change is done, there is no effect for the liquefaction, because under specific pressure only this is there. They started it to do it with the same another CO2 at different temperature, different volume. They found it that the liquefaction point decreased. Now during this case, initially B and C, but now it's a D and E. The point has been decreased. Only a smaller duration is there. By rising even the higher temperature, they found it that the graph even shows a smaller factor. Even smaller factor was there, right? Particularly, you can say that this was at 13.1 degrees Celsius, this was at 21 degrees Celsius, particularly at the graph, we got it as the cow graph. That means there was only a point, at which liquid crystals were being founded, or the gas got converted into liquid. Above that temperature, we never got it into a liquid state. So what does it show? The graph shows that at particular temperature or at particular points, the liquid formations of the gaseous molecules take place at specific temperature and pressure. If this temperature and pressure is there, then only you are going to get it, the liquid point. Above that, whatever the pressure is applied, you are never going to get the liquid. Below that, if this much is the temperature, then this will be the pressure condition that will be required to convert it into liquid state. So at specific temperature and pressure, the liquefactions of the gases are possible. Right? So that is the theory that is given in our book. Now these were the theories that we were having it for the gaseous molecules. These all the concepts are there for the gaseous molecules. The next concept that we are having it now for the liquids. Now the property of the liquid, we know it. It's a fluidity is there. Liquid can flow from one to the other. On the basis of that fluidity itself, we are having it as in three concepts to study. One is vapor pressure, another one is surface tension, and the third one is viscosity. One by one we will take it as the first one. We will take it as a vapor pressure. The vapor pressure is defined as the pressure exerted by the vapors on the free surface of the liquid. The pressure applied by the vapors on free surface of the liquid is known as now we will understand it by a certain diagram so that it becomes much easier for us. I'm taking it as one of the container. It's filled with a liquid. Half of the container is filled with a liquid. This is what liquid we are having it. Now, if we are heating it, what will happen? They will start to vaporize and occupy in a form of gaseous component. Right? If it is an open vessel, this vapors will be going into the atmosphere and mixing in it. So there won't be any kind of a pressure over there on the liquid. But at the same time, if this container is closed, I'm closing it with a certain lid on it, then what will happen? Initially, the vapors will be occupying the empty space that is present in the container. A stage will come where they won't have any more further spaces available. So that means that is considered to be as an equilibrium state. Equilibrium will be established between the liquid and gaseous component. Now after that also, when the vapors will be created, what will happen? These vapors will start to apply a pressure on the uppermost surface of the liquid. Right? Because gas cannot go inside the liquid. So it will apply the pressure on the free surface of the liquid. The pressure which is applied by these vapors on the free surface of the liquid is known as vapor pressure. Now, at the same time, when this vapor pressure becomes equal to external pressure, then the temperature at which it happens is known as its boiling point. The temperature at which this happens. For example, if I tell you that a question is there, at what temperature water boils? Immediately all of you will start to say that, sir, it's 100 degrees Celsius, we know it. But if I ask you, Are you sure that it's at 100 degrees Celsius every time? Then let us understand it. That if you are saying that the vapor pressure, the boiling point of the water is 100 degrees Celsius, that means the water will convert itself into water vapor at 100 degrees Celsius only. So my question is there, that when I pour up water on the floor, after some time, there is no water. That means, where is that water then? You will say that, sir, it has been vaporized. It has converted itself into the water vapor. My question was, is the floor 100 degrees Celsius, where it made the water to convert into a water vapor? No, the floor is not at 100 degrees Celsius. Then why did that water got converted into water vapor? Did I heated it? Oh, no. Right? It was an open container. The vapors started to form and the vapor was vaporized. Right? So at that time it was not 100 degree. But when is considered to be as 100 degree? When this vapor pressure inside the container becomes equal to external pressure. Okay. Now this was an, just a question where we proved it that it's not the temperature of the floor is 100 degrees Celsius. Now, give reason. Or the question is, at present the more normal condition, we are asking the question, what is the boiling point of the water? You are immediately saying it 100 degrees Celsius. We ask you, don't reply the answer. The reason is, first of all, ask the question. Sir, where you are going to ask, at which condition you are asking the water vapor, boiling point of the water. The reason is, when you are at a sea level, the pressure is 1 atmospheric pressure. When I am going on to the higher altitude, that means if I go it on the mountainous region, like suppose let us take it that I am going on a Mount Abu. From Gandhinagar to Mount Abu, the sea level has been changed. Right? The pressure, whatever is at the Gandhinagar, is different than the pressure that we are exerting or feeling it at Mount Abu. From Mount Abu, I am going to the Mount Everest. Over there, the pressure is still less. So what will be the change? Will the boiling point of the water at these three places are same? Is the boiling point of the water at Gandhinagar, if it is at 100 degrees Celsius, will it be 100 degrees Celsius at Mount Abu? Answer is no. The boiling point of the water at Mount Abu is never 100 degrees Celsius, it's hardly 80 degrees Celsius. And when I'm measuring it as a Mount Everest, it's hardly 60 degrees Celsius. The boiling point of the water at Everest, it's a 60 degree. Why it happens so? The reason is over here. What is the boiling point? Vapor pressure equals to external pressure. When I'm measuring it at Gandhinagar, the vapor pressure inside it is 1 atmospheric pressure, outside is 1 atmospheric pressure. But when I'm going out on the Mount Abu, the external pressure is suppose 0.8 inside. I need only 0.8 to be brought. So for that, my temperature has to be decreased. So boiling point also reduced. So at higher altitudes, boiling point of the liquids are less than that of the normal ground levels, right? So this is what we want to remember, vapor pressure, right? Okay, second term, that is surface tension. Second term that we want to indicate is surface tension. Now what is surface tension? When we are talking about the surface tension, so we know it that if I put something into a liquid, then what will happen? The certain things will shrink, certain things are floating on it, right? Now why that difference is there? The difference is because of the force that is acting onto that substance. There are the two types of forces that are acting onto the surface of the liquid. One is gravitational force, which is pulling the substance inside or in the downward direction. But at the same time, in the liquid, there is a buoyancy force which is making the substance to come in the upward direction, the resultant force on the surface of the liquid, the one as a gravitational force, one as a buoyancy force. When these two forces, the resultant force which is obtained on the surface of the liquid, if it is able to hold the substance, then it will keep on floating it. But if the mass of that substance is much higher or the gravitational force is more onto it, it will shrink. The same experiment, if we want to do it, we can say that if I take it as a metal strip and if I give you and say that throw it in the water, what will happen? It will shrink, right? But a small metal strip was unable to float. The steamer is made up of metal only and it keeps on floating in the ocean. Now what is the reason behind it? The reason is the steamers which are floating in the ocean, they are having it as in the water containing number of salts present in it, and that buoyancy forces are increasing, the surface tension forces are changed, and that is why it keeps on floating it. The same steamer cannot be brought into the river to float. It will shrink. The reason is river has a sweet water. There are less number of salts present in it. And that's the reason why they cannot float. So that is because of surface tension. Second factor of the surface tension. You would have always observed that whenever you take it, any of the liquid, any liquid, it will always fall in the form of drop, which is spherical. They never form a square. They never form a triangle. They always, the drops are spherical. What is the reason behind this spherical? Again, the answer is surface tension. All the forces of the liquid that are making them to pull it in the inner direction. So they are all going into the centers, and as a result, they form spheres. So that is because of the surface tension. The forces that are pulling all the molecules towards the center of it, making it to be as a spherical. And therefore, the liquids always forms the drops which are spherical, right? Similarly, you can say that the capillary actions, the liquids that have been pulled in the upward direction without any forces, under a certain diameters. So that is because of capillary action. Again, over there also, the capillary action is because of surface tension, okay? And the third factor, that is viscosity. What is the viscosity? It's a resistance force acting between the two layers of the liquid. We know that the liquids are having it as a tendency to flow. And we don't have it as a single layer. Number of layers of the liquids are there. Each layer is keep on flowing it. There is a certain resultant force that is being, resistance force which obstruct the liquid to flow. That resistant force which is acting between the layers of the liquid is considered to be as a viscosity. Now this viscosity is because of hydrogen bond or van der Waals forces. If there are strong hydrogen bonds or more van der Waals forces, the viscosity of the liquid is more, so fluidity is less and the thickness of the liquid is increased. For an example, you can say that water is having lesser viscosity compared to that of oils. Oil cannot flow easily. Water will flow easily. The reason is oils are having higher viscous. They are having higher hydrogen bonding or van der Waals forces present in them. Whereas in the case of water, there is a lesser, and therefore they can flow very easily. Right? So that is because of hydrogen and van der Waals forces. More the viscous liquid, less is the fluidity. Less the viscous liquid, more is the fluidity, right? But at the same time, the viscosity is also the factor which is affected by the temperature. If you rise the temperature, the mobility of the liquid increases. That means the viscosity of the liquid will decrease, fluidity will increase. The same experiment, you can see it at home by taking it as a normal oil. If you dip your finger in it and think it that the drop will be formed, or in place of finger, just take it as in, suppose a spoon, dip it in it and then put it, the drop to be followed, and just do it with a hot boiled oil after frying something, the temperature of that oil is high. Try to do it with the same spoon with that also. The difference you will be able to see, that the cold temp cold oil, it won't flow easily. Why? The hot oil will flow out very easily. That means it's a because of viscosity change, and that viscosity change is because of temperature, right? This was all the theoretical things that we are discussing with. Read the theory, read it in the detail, word to word, line to line from your textbook, so that you can understand even better, right? This was a theory, that is the end of the chapter that we are having it as a chapter number 5. In our next lecture, we will start with a new chapter, that is thermodynamics. Thank you.